beginning of our Lenten lecture series, the Book of Exodus, A Spiritual Journey. Our lecture series is hosted by the McGrath Institute for Church Life, where I'm happy to work. The Institute is committed to the mission of nourishing the Catholic imagination and renewing the church. Our Institute takes on the special task of offering the many resources of the university for the service of the church, while also allowing the church to continually enrich and inform the university of its own distinctive Catholic mission. In other words, we seek to unseal the riches of the academy for the life of the church, and we also seek to intentionally channel the beauty of the life of the church into the research and teaching of the academy. Our humble lecture series that begins tonight falls within that wider mission. As many of you know, we have recommended taking up the book of Exodus as spiritual reading for Lent, reading one chapter a day for the 40 days. To assist us in our reading, reflection, and prayer, we have prepared a reading guide that is free and available to the public on our series webpage. We've formed local discussion groups as well as online groups so that those who are reading Exodus during this liturgical season can join together for conversation not only about the text, but also about their journeys as readers of Scripture. Finally, a group of more than 30 undergraduate students are partaking in a credit-bearing theology course built around the Book of Exodus, with these public lectures doubling as class lectures for them. In these multiple forms, the life of the university is being turned outwards in service of the church, while the rhythms of the church's liturgical life are informing some of the regular academic and formational work of the university. We hope these lectures will help you contemplate prevalent themes of Exodus as they relate to the spiritual life of each soul and of the life of the church. By reading Exodus as a spiritual journey, that is patiently, reverently, even theologically, we will allow the words of Scripture, along with its images and figures, to reveal to us the Savior for whom we long. And though not himself the Savior, tonight's lecturer will point the way towards him from within the Book of Exodus. Had he not been otherwise occupied with delivering a lecture tonight, Professor John Cavadini likely would have been the one to welcome you here, since he is the McGrath-Cavadini Director of the McGrath Institute for Church Life. In other words, he's the boss. John Cavadini is also a professor of theology in our department, where he previously served as chair for 13 years. A scholar of the early church with notable specialties in Augustine and Origen, among others, he is also a master of what we might call catechetical theology, teaching undergraduates and graduate students how to perceive the beauty and logic of the mystery of the church's faith, while also preparing catechists and theologians alike as leaders for the church and the academy for generations to come. Some of the more recent conferences and subsequent publications that he has orchestrated show the breadth of his engagement in and vision for the renewal of church life, with such titles as Mary on the Eve of the Second Vatican Council, The Charism of Priestly Celibacy, Biblical, Theological, and Pastoral Reflections, and Explorations in the Theology of Pope Benedict XVI. Lastly, I ought to mention that Professor Cavadini offered a stunning lecture in last year's Lenten series, which focused on Dante's Commedia, for which he himself took on the theme of sin in the Inferno. You may have noticed that his topic tonight also focuses on sin, suggesting to us that perhaps he is the resident expert on the subject. But whether that expertise has been acquired through study or experience, I assure you I am not in a position to comment, because he's my boss. To deliver his lecture on sin, mercy, and the vision of God in the Book of Exodus, please join me in welcoming Professor John Cavadini.
Thanks, Lenny. I'll talk to you later about some of those things. So, friends, nice to see you all, and thank you for coming. Since I'm the first lecturer, I thought I would make an attempt, besides or using the theme that I've chosen, to try to give a kind of overview of the book of Exodus, so you kind of have a sense of where we're beginning and where we're going. It is appropriate for us to pause during Lent to reflect upon the book of Exodus, in case you were wondering. In fact, the book of Exodus, along with related readings from the books of Leviticus and Numbers, are prescribed for the liturgy of the hours, and specifically Matins, the office of readings, as it is now called, for the first 4 weeks of Lent, until Passiontide, when the letter to the Hebrews takes over. In this way, the church asks us to consider Lent as a journey cast in the pattern of the exodus of the children of Israel from Egypt. Of course, we're not undertaking a physical journey from a country called Egypt across the Red Sea into the desert on our way to another geographical territory promised to us by God. And yet we should not too hastily separate the physical journey of Israel, as recounted in the book of Exodus, from the spiritual journey that we undertake in Lent, which is itself a kind of microcosm of the Christian life as a whole. In fact, if you think about it, the physical journey of Israel was a spiritual journey at the same time. The two journeys, the physical and the spiritual, fully coincided. God granted Israel freedom from Egypt and led Israel out into the desert on their way to the promised land. But as soon as they were safely in the desert, they realized, well, that they were in a desert. Maybe it had felt nice to stick it to the Egyptians and sing a couple of songs about it. But after all, was freedom really worth all that would be required to survive in the desert? Wouldn't it be better to be back in Egypt? At least there was food and water. Is freedom really all that it's chalked up to be? Throughout the narratives of Exodus and the related narratives of the books of Leviticus and Numbers, the Israelites spend their time romanticizing their stay in Egypt. Even after God has repeatedly, we might say even routinely, provided water miraculously and fed them daily with bread from heaven, the manna, their whole time in the desert. Here's what they say at one point, remembering very vividly the rations in Egypt. In a passage prescribed for the office of readings on Wednesday of the fourth week of Lent, quote, "And the children of Israel wept again and said, 'Who shall give us flesh to eat? We remember the fish which we did eat in Egypt freely, the cucumbers and the melons and the leeks and the onions and the garlic. But now our soul is dried away. There's nothing at all besides this manna before our eyes,'" end quote. Numbers 11, 5 through 6 in the inimitable King James Version. Actually, the menu in Egypt, the bread of slavery, was enough to cause the Israelites to regard with contempt and distaste the bread of freedom, which God gave them directly from heaven. It seems as though freedom is an acquired taste. Sorry. The story of the Exodus is the story of how the children of Israel, with the help of God every step of the way, finally acquired that taste, however precariously possessed. Thus we see it's not simply the story of a physical journey, but truly of a spiritual journey. The physical landscape is at the same time a new spiritual topography to be negotiated by Israel? And what about us? Can we recognize the same spiritual topography, even if the physical landscapes of our lives are different? Is this journey, as the church prescribes it in Lent, so unrecognizable? The point in reading these texts is not to reflect on how ridiculously hard-hearted the children of Israel were, but to locate and to reflect on our own taste for the menu of unfreedom. With regard to the passage I just read, is it really so unfamiliar? We too, as the people of God, are fed daily with bread from heaven, the Eucharistic bread of freedom, of which the manna was a type. I'm sure you've never done this, but speaking for myself, I have thought, okay, is this it? Is this all there is? This stuff? It's so ordinary. Am I scandalizing you? Sorry. This bread, isn't there something more? Some interior consolation? Some advanced spiritual experience that will let me see through and behind to the real thing? Couldn't the sacramentum caritatis, the sacrament of divine love, be a little more interesting? Something like cucumbers, leeks, onions, and of course garlic. How about a few visions at least? Apparently the freedom of the Eucharistic life of self-giving is an acquired taste too. But this mention of vision leads me into the specific topic I've set for myself for this evening's reflection. And that is the vision of God. Have you ever wanted to see God? Isn't that the proper goal of a spiritual journey? Former Beatle George Harrison thought so. "I really want to see you, Lord," he sang. I'm dating myself. As he also wistfully added, "but it takes so long." I would like to suggest this issue of the vision of God, what it might be, and how long it does or does not take, is one of the main themes in the book of Exodus. Perhaps our Lenten journey, in imitation of Israel, is in fact a journey to the vision of God, a visionary journey, the dimensions of which we might learn to appreciate more fully by investigating the theme as the book of Exodus presents it. We might think of the book of Exodus, in a way, as a series of profiles in the vision of God. Ready? Who sees God in the book of Exodus? All of the people of Israel see the mighty wonders of God as he forces Pharaoh with his mighty arm to let the Israelites go, and as he leads them through the Red Sea with a wall of water on their right and one on their left. Did those who witnessed these wonders see God? What about the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud that led the people? Did those who see the pillar see God? Before God descended on Mount Sinai, Moses had the people wash their clothes, nice detail, and in general try to look presentable for their meeting with God. The text tells us that then, quote, "Moses led the people to meet God," end quote, and that God kept his appointment and, quote, "descended upon the mountain in fire, and the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly," end quote. Not exactly someone you invite to 4 o'clock tea. But nevertheless, God did keep his appointment, came down upon the mountain. Did the people see God? I know a lot of people, including myself, who could settle for a vision like that, a great theophany as a vision of God, including some biblical writers who long for these times of God's dramatic action later in the Bible and say, "Would that you would rend the heavens and come down." In other words, "I want to see you." Moses himself, of course, famously enters the cloud, or the thick darkness, we are told, where God was, while the people stood off. Later on, this is Exodus 20. Later on in this text, this sequence is reprised, but in an expanded form. This is Exodus 24. After the covenant is ratified, we are told that a small group ascended the mountain. To what degree they ascended, we're not told. As follows, quote, "Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of sapphire stone, and as clear as the sky itself. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. They saw God, and they still could eat and drink." End quote. Finally, the text says it outright. They saw God and lived. Note, he has feet, and he stood on the sky. An anthropomorphic form, if a heavenly one. At last we know what God looks like. Isn't that gratifying? But the text, just as it seems to have given us an answer, immediately problematizes it. We learn in the very next verse that out of this group who had just seen God so conveniently, Moses receives a special invitation. Quote, "Come up to me into the mountain and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written, and thou mayest teach them." Exodus 24:12. So Moses ascends as requested. We read, quote, "After Moses had gone up, a cloud covered the mountain, and the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai. And the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire on top of the mountain in the eyes of the children of Israel who were looking from a safe distance. But Moses passed into the midst of the cloud as he went up on the mountain, and there he stayed for 40 days and 40 nights. Exodus 24, 15 through 18. The people of Israel, notice, are expressly said to have sighted the glory of the Lord. They saw it. And yet again, what the text gives with one hand, it takes back with the other. For Moses passes into the dark cloud and stays there 40 days. And we're led to believe he had a much more intimate encounter with God than the people did in broad daylight. An encounter, further, more intimate than the vision which the elders of Israel saw just a few verses ago. This passage about the cloud of darkness is, of course, a favorite one of the mystics. A cloud not of seeing, but of unseeing. A cloud not of knowing, but of unknowing. The text has blocked all of our efforts to seize the vision of God and to brag about what we have seen. It deflects our curiosity and exposes it as such. And we are left literally in the dark. Although we're given a kind of hint, most of the 40 days that Moses is communing with God on the mountain, God, having already written down the law, is giving further and very lengthy and detailed instructions for the making of the tabernacle and all its associated furniture and vestments. This goes on for several chapters. Most readers skip it. I hate to say it. Most readers skim through what seems to be a tiresome episode, hoping to find the next mention of the vision of God and overlooking what Moses is told in the dark cloud. Though the church fathers, such as Origen and Gregory of Nyssa, do not move so fleetingly through these chapters of the text, but instead actually linger lovingly on the details of how the tabernacle is to be constructed. I'll come back to that. In order to salvage our pride after being so impolitely and efficaciously blocked by the text in our attempts to see God. And it hardly helps to realize that it was the Holy Spirit in the Word of God who blocked us. After all, we can't see him either. Why don't we try to go back to the beginning of the text of Exodus to see where this theme is first announced and try again? On Saturday after Ash Wednesday, the very famous text from Exodus 3, recounting the burning bush and God's revelation of the divine name, is prescribed for our reading. And I think that actually coincides with what's on the bookmark. Let's look at it carefully. The book of Exodus makes rapid progress through chapters 1 and 2, from the enslavement of the people, to the order of Pharaoh to kill all the male children of the Hebrews, to the birth of Moses, his providential rescue by Pharaoh's daughter, right to the marriage of Moses and his first two children in self-imposed exile from his home country of Egypt. After this, the text slows down considerably. We're told in the most laconic fashion possible, the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage. And they cried, and their cry came up to God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them, end quote. End of Exodus 2. This is the prelude to the story of the burning bush, which comes next. Note that it reports a vision of God, not our vision of God, but God's own act of vision. Having heard the groans of the people, God looked to see what it was about, and his look prompted the action that is now about to unfold. So the whole story of the burning bush comes after the notice that God looked upon the people and saw their affliction. Quote, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked. And behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. Exodus 3, 1 through 3. The text is very emphatic here in raising the theme of the vision of God. The angel of the Lord, meaning some representative of God, close enough to be, as it were, almost transparent to God, appeared. And Moses looked. And then noticing that the bush, though on fire, was not consumed, made a decision to interrupt his trek and look more closely to see this great sight. The Lord, when he saw that Moses turned aside to see, Exodus 3, 4, thus making Moses' quest for vision even more emphasized, he called to Moses out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. He calls Moses by name significantly. And Moses answers, here I am. God warns Moses to take off his sandals and not to come any closer, identifying himself as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the text tells us, Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God, end quote. That's a significant detail to tuck into the back of your imagination. Moses, it turned out, has good reason to hide his face and not to look at God. For in the next verse, we're reminded that this whole episode began with a report of God's seeing. Quote, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them. Exodus 3, 7 to 8. For God to see affliction is for God to know it, we might say, to understand it, to care about it, and to act. So there isn't any difference in God's seeing, God's caring, God's understanding, and God's acting. Perhaps Moses is getting the idea that if he is to see God, he will have to see what God sees and how God sees it. And lo and behold, the worst does happen from Moses' point of view. And I am coming down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land, unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, we are told. And then the text emphasizes God's seeing by repeating what God heard and saw. Quote, "Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them." Perhaps Moses is thinking he could afford a small peek now. Maybe the danger is over. But God goes on to say, as if it were the most natural follow-up in the world, "Come now, therefore, I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." Exodus 3:10. And Moses said unto God, "I did not see that coming." Well, that's a paraphrase. He actually says, "Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" 3:10. "I thought you said you were going to do that," I added. God goes on to assure Moses that he will be with him and adds, "And this shall be a sign unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain." Exodus 3:12. Perhaps not exactly the kind of sign Moses was hoping for, since it will occur after all the work is done. Moses needs more reassurance than that. And then, although God has already identified himself as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Moses asks God for further information, that is, for his name. He is thinking that possessing the name of God will authorize him further in the minds of those he must persuade of his own credibility. In a moment of desperation, perhaps, he links his own credibility with God's name, that is, with God's credibility. God does not leave him unsatisfied. Quote, "And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you." This is the famous revelation of the divine name to Moses. Hereafter, in the text, always represented by the circumlocution Adonai in Hebrew, translated into English as Lord, and represented in English Bibles with all caps, to distinguish it precisely as the circumlocution for God's name, Yahweh, from other uses of the word Lord. So you see what happens here? God actually reveals his name for the first time to Moses, and the text writes it out, "I am who I am." But the text of the Bible ever after that always uses a circumlocution because the name of God is so sacred that the Jews wouldn't write it down for fear that the paper would be burnt. And they wouldn't speak it for fear that it would be profaned. So when you see in your Bibles, as you're reading the book of Exodus, Lord, with that curious all caps, the L is bigger, but it's still all caps, that always means it's a circumlocution for the divine name, Yahweh, I am who I am. God assures Moses that this is his name forever, his memorial unto all generations. And that is a promise, namely, that his name reflects his faithfulness, which will never change and always be remembered. I have to add, incidentally, because we tend to gloss over this passage as though it were nothing for God to reveal his name. So I have to add that if I were God, I would have avoided this gesture. Perhaps if God had a better career counselor, he would have chosen another course. I certainly would have advised it. After all, it's a little like Queen Elizabeth handing someone a business card with a nickname like Liz on it. Or even like Her Majesty wearing a name tag at a conference. Don't you think that's a come down? For the queen to wear a name tag? Why? Because I'm the queen. You're supposed to know who I am. Which is why when you go to an academic conference, for those of you who've had the unfortunate experience, anyone not wearing the name tag? A little bit dubious, because it could be that they think that they're important enough not to have to wear it. But who's more important than God? And yet, here's my business card. Call me. Queens, going back to Queen Elizabeth, just don't do that. It's too common, too accessible, too embarrassing to majesty. And yet God, who has all the majesty in the world, signified by telling Moses to take his shoes off, doesn't hesitate at all to bend down and give his name. The sacredness of the name of God is not only in the name itself, but in the act of delivering the name, which flows directly from God's seeing, as he now instructs Moses to tell the people, "Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say unto them, the Lord," so here's the circumlocution, "God of your fathers appeared to me, saying, I have surely visited you and seen that which is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt unto a land flowing with milk and honey." Only after this does God assure Moses that he will work some more respectable signs. You know, the turning of the staff into a serpent, his hand into a leprous hand, and then back, and then the plagues. The point being that they are not independent wonders, but all signs of God's seeing and God's giving to Moses the most intimate thing that he can give, his name. Philo, the Jewish commentator, the turn of the millennium, commenting on this passage, poignantly noted that God doesn't need a name. In other words, God's giving his name to Moses means God's giving himself to Moses in an utterly gratuitous act of self-emptying and mercy that I would have counseled him against, as I pointed out. We have learned a lot about what it means for God to see at this point. But what about what it means to see God? For that, we have to take leave of Exodus 3, you might be relieved to know, and move considerably forward into the text to the point just after we left Moses on Mount Sinai, receiving the instructions for the tabernacle in which God's presence is to dwell, and then the tablets on which the law is written. Everyone familiar with the story knows that in chapter 32, because 40 days and 40 nights was too long for the people to wait for Moses, we have the story of Israel's apostasy, the story of the golden calf. The whole episode is over in one chapter, chapter 32. In verse 7, the Lord tells Moses to go down the mountain, for, he says pointedly, your people, which you brought out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. And the text adds, even more pointedly, and the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation, end quote. Here's another instance of the Lord seeing. Only what he sees prompts him to judgment. Moses quickly entreats the Lord on behalf of the people. But when he himself finally reaches the camp, and he saw, the text says, the calf, his, quote, anger waxed hot as well. And he breaks the tablets of the law and orders the people to be punished. Yet after the punishment, Moses takes up his intercession on behalf of the people once again. Quote, "And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, Oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book, which thou hast written." End quote. Mysterious passage where God, where Moses intercedes with God by offering, by saying he doesn't want any inheritance that the people doesn't get. Nothing doing, God starkly replies, "Whosoever hath sinned against me, him I will blot out of my book." In other words, not you. But justice must be done. And then he adds, "Therefore now go, lead the people unto the place of which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, my angel shall go before thee. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them." End quote. Exodus 32:34. God insists that he will send an angel with Moses who can lead the people unto a land flowing with milk and honey. But, quote, "I will not go up in the midst of thee, for thou art a stiff-necked people, lest I consume thee in the way," end quote. So you see what's happening? God is saying, "I'll keep my promise. You can lead the people. I'll send an angel with you, but I'm not coming." The people mourn at this news, and Moses bides his time. The Lord, we discover, despite his disavowal, still appears in the column of cloud, Exodus 33, and though he does not enter the column of cloud, he stands at the door of the tent of meeting, conversing with Moses, who enters the tent of meeting, about the affairs of the people. The people, for their part, can see the column of cloud standing at the door of the tent of meeting. And we are told in one of the most famous passages of the book of Exodus, because of its most intimate of terms, quote, "And the Lord spoke unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend," end quote. Exodus 33:11. If ever anyone could make a claim on seeing God, indeed, face to face, would it not be Moses, just here, at this point? Moses has seen everything God has seen, though in each case, because God has seen it, and directed Moses' attention to it. Moses now asks God, on the basis of what vision God has shared with him, to relent. Moses has seen God. He knows God as a friend, and that he, Moses, is seeing as God sees. Or so Moses thinks. There ensues the most intimate and frank conversation recorded in the Bible, and it's worth reading the book of Exodus just to get to this point. Moses tells God that he has said he knows him, Moses, by name. And he has found grace in God's sight. But has he? Moses asks. He continues, "Now therefore, I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is your people," end quote, Exodus 33:13. God insists in reply that his presence will go with him, Moses, and not with the people. But for Moses, that is not enough. He wants the original deal, that God himself, as he said from the burning bush, will bring the people up to the promised land. "For how," Moses asks God, "shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that you go up with us?" End quote. The writer of the book of Exodus has created a hush around this passage as if the whole cosmos is waiting to see what God will do to Moses, who has dared to argue with him. Quote, "And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing that thou hast spoken. For you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name. Exodus 33:17. It's a shame that the Liturgy of the Hours actually leaves out just this passage, Wednesday, third week of Lent. For Moses could not have received a more gratifying reply. And the reader heaves a huge sigh of relief. But it turns out Moses wants more. We can see that this passage is perfectly choreographed to correspond to the earlier passage, the passage about the burning bush. There Moses hid his face, remember, for he was afraid to look on God. But now, as a result of God's reply, the text tells us, and Moses said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Exodus 33:18. Another blocking move with respect to the reader by the text of Exodus. Finally, we thought, we found the vision of God. Moses spoke to God face to face, as a friend to a friend, and even wrested a concession from God. Isn't that enough? And yet, Moses hasn't seen enough. He wants to be shown God's glory, and the reader must move on too. What takes place next in the biblical text is one of the most mysterious and commented on passages in all of Scripture. In a sense, God yells at Moses, but I have to add, in the nicest, gentlest, most courteous way possible, if God or anyone else wants to yell at me in this way, have at it. In effect, God says, I'm paraphrasing, what? You're asking to see my glory? I let you argue with me face to face. I let you remonstrate with me. And instead of consuming you with hot, fiery wrath, I relented on your plea alone. That's not glory enough for you? Then what are you looking for? What do you want to see? End quote. I should have written the Bible. But of course, God doesn't say it that way. In a way, God agrees to Moses' request, though he qualifies it. Quote, and he said, God said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee. Just as he did, remember, in chapter 3, when he first proclaimed his name. So these passages match. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see my face and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. I'll put thee in, yeah. And I will take my hand away, and you shall see my back parts, whatever they are. But my face shall not be seen, end quote. Exodus 33:19-23. So Moses is promised the vision of God's back. Friends, it's an anthropomorphic text in one way, but don't worry about it. Go with the flow. The anthropomorphism relativizes itself as we go along. The reader is not allowed a moment to remonstrate, but the text said they conversed face to face already. The reader is summarily overwhelmed with a vision. In high visionary mode, we learn next how great God's mercy will be. The very next verse, quote, and the Lord said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone like to the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first ones, which thou broke. Again, these words are left out of the office of readings. I don't know why. But not out of our course of readings. and be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present yourself to me at the top of the mountain. Exodus 34, 1 and 2. Just as we thought we too had seen God, he ups the ante. He's going to take the time to rewrite with his own hand the law so that the people will know him, will have his will, and be able to be formed in the way that he, the Lord, sees things. In other words, the Lord announces that he intends to renew the broken covenant. Moses does as commanded, taking no one with him as also commanded. And then we must simply listen to the sublime words of the text. And here they are. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for 1,000 generations and forgiving wickedness and crime and sin, yet not declaring the guilty guiltless, but punishing to the third and fourth generation for their father's wickedness. And Moses at once bowed down to the ground and worshiped. Exodus 34, 5 through 8. Why is it that just here the text tells us in a hieratic moment that Moses bowed down to worship? It did not tell us that in the episode which this one carefully matches and at the same time fulfills, namely the episode of the burning bush. There too God revealed his name to Moses. But here God tells Moses the meaning of his name, though Moses should have been able to catch it from the first, when God revealed his name in the process of coming down to deliver the people out of his compassion. Here we see the extent of the compassion, more fully than even Moses had imagined it. Yes, he who saw God face to face. Here we see the extent of that compassion in the renewal and restoration of the covenant, which Moses hadn't even dreamed of asking for. The mysterious back parts of God for which Moses must settle, these are all that we can see of God in this life. Namely, the mercy of God, which does not overlook crime and reacts with justice, and yet submerges even that justice in an unimaginable ocean of mercy 1,000 times greater. Moses, are you looking for something greater than the mercy of God? The back parts. The face is hid for now in God's mercy, which you saw, which was extended to you yourself and the whole people with you. And yet somehow it wasn't enough for you. There is nothing more. That's me, the Lord, my mercy. When Moses truly sees this, he bows down in worship. We could say the deepest and most profound act of vision in the whole of the book of Exodus, this act of worship. After this, Moses' face, though unbeknownst to him, permanently shines with the reflected glow of his vision, so much so that the people of Israel can't bear to look on his face, as though they were looking on the glory of God. After this, there are no more theophanies in the book of Exodus. Moses comes down from the mountain, and the tabernacle is constructed, and the book ends with the fulfillment of God's promise of presence. Quote, after the tabernacle is constructed, then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Not even Moses can enter while the presence fills the tabernacle, though the presence of God leaves the tabernacle when the cloud is needed to lead the people forward. So when the presence leaves the tabernacle, it becomes the cloud and leads the people. Quote, for the cloud of the Lord was upon the tabernacle by day, and fire was on it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. That's the end of the book of Exodus. Does it seem anticlimactic? That presence is God's seeing, is God's knowing, is God's acting, is God's mercy. The people become defined by the presence of the mercy of God indwelling them. And they learn progressively to see from this perspective, to follow God, and so in that way to worship and at once to see. So what is the book telling us? Do you want to see God? Follow him. The seeing is in the following. In a sense, my paper should end there. But of course, I want to take it one step further. The great exegetes of the Christian tradition commented copiously on this passage where Moses where God allows Moses to see his back parts. And I want to look very briefly at one of the greatest of these commentators, namely St. Augustine. Like all of the fathers of the church who commented on the passage, Augustine noticed how, in a sense, the text of Exodus shows that Moses did receive a vision of God, and yet at the same time, something like the refusal of a vision. There is, ultimately, no direct vision of God in this life. Like Israel, we have not reached the promised land, and our vision of God must be of his back parts, as appropriate to those who are being led, who are following God, and not leading. Like the blind Bartimaeus in the Gospel of Mark, we have our vision in following Jesus on the way of the cross, not by avoiding it and holding out for something better than the vision of the back of the one who came in mercy to ransom the many by giving his life. If we're looking for more than that, we're looking for more than exists anywhere. Same message as in the book of Exodus. Augustine, accordingly, like most of the fathers of the church, interprets the back parts of God as the incarnate Jesus, a prophecy of the incarnate Jesus, the flesh of Christ. He allegorizes the text accordingly. Augustine interprets God's reply to Moses' request to see his glory as a prophecy, an announcement of Christ, a prefiguration, he says, quote, of the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, taking his back to mean his flesh, in which he was born of the Virgin, died and rose again, while his face would be his divinity, that is, the form of God in which he did not think it robbery to be equal to God the Father, Philippians 2:6, in which, of course, no man can see and live. It is interesting what happens next in the allegory is not simply that the Old Testament passage is interpreted as a prophecy and then dismissed as fulfilled in Christ, but that it's used to help us understand what is revealed in Christ and what faith in Christ is like. We spiritually see God's wisdom precisely to the extent that we bow down and worship the incarnate one. That is, that we have faith in the incarnation, passion, death, and resurrection of Christ. Augustine comments, but while we are far away from the Lord and walking by faith and not by sight, we have to behold Christ's back, that is, his flesh. By the same faith, standing, that is, upon the solid foundation of the lookout on the rock, the cleft in the rock, namely the Catholic Church. All the surer is our love for the face of Christ, which we long to see, the more clearly we recognize in his back how much Christ first loved us. So the allegory is a little different, difficult to follow, but you see what he's saying? He's saying that, in a sense, the full vision of God is postponed till the next life. The way we see now is by our faith, looking on the back parts of God, namely the flesh of Christ. And he expects the reader to push back. Yeah, but I want to see something. I want to see the real thing. This is just flesh. I want to see the essence of God. How's that? Augustine replies to this outburst that it is in particular our faith in the resurrection of Jesus' body that saves and justifies us. Because the resurrection, he says, is the passing by of the Lord's majesty. In the glory of his resurrection and ascension to the Father, and in that passing by, were established on the rock in faith. From that vantage point, faith in the proclamation of the resurrection by the church, his back parts can be seen. And this doesn't mean simply the physical seeing of his flesh, if you think about it. But what we see in faith is the meaning of that flesh, namely, the love by which Christ first loved us, and which is not simply signified by his flesh, so that we try to look behind it, but is his flesh, and always will be. We see by faith in the resurrection and ascension of Christ the meaning of the story of the passion and death of the Lord, which Lent verges on. When we too, in the person of the apostles, had thought for certain that he was eliminated, liquidated, like any other man. Because not even the miracles he did, like the miracles God worked in the Old Testament, had enabled the apostles and us along with him to see or acknowledge him fully. Faith in the resurrection and ascension of the Lord establishes us on the rock, the lookout, the church, as the possibility of vision of the love, the enormous pity and mercy of God in Christ. The upshot of this, friends, is that we don't have to seek a separate place from which to see. And that is the importance of the use of language of vision in association with faith here. We don't have to settle for a partial, self-constructed vision through philosophical or other esoteric techniques, when in the church, we as believers, we already have it all. Our faith is visionary in a plenipotentiary way. Do we want an intellectual vision that is more sophisticated, more elevated, more clear and distinct, in other words, more self-made than the back parts of God, his incarnation, passion, and death? Are we looking for something behind that? For Augustine to hold out for a direct vision as ultimately eschatological is for him at the same time to hold up faith and the whole of ecclesial life in which it is expressed as itself bristling with visionary potential, with seeing. And so something which we can embrace fully, not hedging our bets by looking for an intellectual vision above it. In other words, are we thinking, you know what, life in the church is fine and all liturgies fine, Eucharist, whatever, and all the works of love that the church prescribes, yeah, but I actually want to see something. Like, I'm tired of all that. I want a vision. And God is saying, well, through the book of Exodus, as interpreted now allegorically, but these are the back parts of God. And like Moses, what that represents is God's mercy in Christ. Do you want to rise above that and see something else? It's a doctrine of confidence, friends. We can, in our desire to see God's face, fully commit ourselves, like Moses, to the love of God and his people, to love of God and neighbor, whereby we love our neighbor by building him up, by encouragement and good example. The life of the church, because it is Eucharistic, formed by the neighborliness of God and drawing us into friendship in Christ, in knowing us by name and feeding us with our daily heavenly bread, is visionary, far beyond what is on offer from the cultivation of mystical techniques, even if the vision for now is irreducibly held by faith. What Augustine is saying is, are you tempted to be ashamed of the sacrifice of Christ? To be ashamed of the church formed by that sacrifice as too little, too low, too embarrassing, too evidently fleshly, opaque and dull? Too much like the back of something instead of the front? Tempted to hold out for a more frontal view? Of what? Is there anything more than the mercy of God outpoured in the blood of Christ that daily forms the church? The more we live the Eucharistic life, Augustine says, the more we have the confidence of living the Eucharistic life, the more we will see as God sees, the more our vision will be configured to the mercy that formed us into the church in the first place, that dwells in the church as its defining sacrament, the more we will realize just how much God so loved the world, and that we are called ever farther and farther into the freedom of this self-giving love. For if we learn anything from the book of Exodus, it is that the one who sees as God sees, sees God. Who needs cucumbers? Thank you.
We have time for a few questions if anybody would have them.
I have to tell you, friends, I'm the kind of person who holds out. Like, I want to see. And what I always have to learn is what these texts are telling us is that you don't have to worry about seeing something. You don't have to worry that there's something out there you're not seeing. You can have confidence that if you do the works of love in the church, if you follow the Eucharistic life, that is where vision is located. That's where visionary experience begins. So you can have confidence to throw yourself into the life of the church rather than fleshly as it is, rather than to try to find a vision, a clear and distinct idea, something apart from it.
That seems like a good place to end. I think the only thing that we should do is to thank our speaker once again for a great lecture.